we go.
Sometimes I feel that I can fight an army with just me and you, and there's no one could harm. Oh, but sometimes I can feel a little shy. It's then I need to know that you are there. That's why
I'm singing here with you when I'm down.
As I pray, I'm singing, be with me Lord,
when I'm down,
be with me Lord,
when I'm lonely,
be with me Lord,
when I'm tired,
be with me,
I need
you
only, be with me Lord,
when I'm
down,
be with me Lord,
when I'm lonely,
be with me Lord,
when I need you Lord,
be with me, be my only God.
Here we go.
Now help me Lord to share what I've been given. Help me make a difference in the life I'm living. As I show my neighbor that you treasure stored, help me know you promise you'll be with me, Lord.
I'm singing,
be with me, Lord,
when I'm down,
be with me, Lord,
when I'm lonely,
be with me, Lord,
when I'm tired,
be with me,
I need
you with me, be with me, Lord,
when I'm down,
be with me, Lord,
when I'm lonely,
be with me, Lord,
when I need you, Lord.
So be with me,
Lord, when I'm down. Please have a seat.
About the black eye, you know? That was a moment of God. What's that? our hope contribution will be moved until next week. Right? One more announcement is that Ministry Retreat's coming up, right, September 20th to 22nd. Please see Mr. Jeff Hawk if you're so interested in going. It's going to be a great time. And more than us to come, Ms. Beth Callback.
Good morning. A few more announcements. You know, I have to say, those years go by in an instant, and those memories are to be cherished, every little story. It's kind of fun standing here this morning and seeing suddenly a lot of sweaters. Wonder what's happening out there. But anyway, to our announcements. First announcement, very important, guys. Women's wellness. As you know, we've been enjoying a summer filled with many, many activities geared towards the women. God has blessed them. Many women have come out to all the Bible talks and the different activities, and many are studying the Bible. But I do want to bring your attention to a couple of things. One is we have a wellness schedule for the 14th of September. We are not going to meet that Saturday morning. There are just so many things going on between the events in Boston and the events around here. We just decided it really would be better to redirect our energy and really focus on the event on October 5th. So really get out there, get your friends invited, and set up to come and enjoy an outstanding program. The same woman from last year is coming back this year. And y'all, if you were there, you remember how awesome that program was. And you know, I hate it when I'm sitting there and I'm thinking, oh, this is so good. I should have pushed and asked so-and-so to come as well. We've already had the moment to sit there, have that feeling, so now let's get behind it and get our friends set up to come. That's not all. We have a couple more wonderful announcements. One, Peggy really sends us her thank yous for all the letters and gifts that we have sent her way, and really continue to pray. There's a possibility she may be graduating to rehab, which, you know, if you're in that bed, that's a big step to go from the hospital and get to rehab. As we know more, like where she is and what's happening, of course, we will keep everyone informed. Also, very exciting for Rick Mall. He has completed another book. He has completed it. I've read it. It's pretty good. He will have a book signing today over at the Bank Square Bookshop in Mystic, and that'll be at 1 p.m. If you'd like to go support him, the warmth of a cheerful face across the table is a very good thing. Then the last announcement.
All that money goes towards the Hope.
Which is incredible. Sure. Thank you very much, Rick. Yep. Our last announcement for today is a reminder that the Marrieds in Hartford are hosting a dinner and dance for Marrieds. That is on November 16th from 6 to 11 p.m. at the Sheraton in Rocky Hill, Connecticut, which Rocky Hill's not that far. It's only about 45 minutes. $95 a couple, which includes your dinner, your entertainment, and your dance. And guess what? You can register online. It's that easy. You can go in the email that Danny sends us every week. He provides a link. Boom, you can click on it, and you're there. Enjoy the rest of your day.
Before you know that, they completed two books, and he wrote two books. Read more than that. He wrote to us. I'm saying a prayer for our service, and after that, we're going to have a team video about what they did for camp, like 7 minutes long, so the pause between three sections, so you'll know the end when the singers come. All right, let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord God, thank you for the blessings that you've given us. Thank you for today as a service, Father. I pray you should be with those who are here, those who are traveling for that, to encourage our brothers and sisters in Boston. I pray with those who are going to deliver the message, as well as those that are teaching, Father. All these things we do, Lord, we do to glorify your name, to lift up one another, and just become closer to you. We love you, Father, in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Some days it'll lift you up, some days it'll call you bluff. Most of my days I ain't got.
Whoa, guys, what is this? We have TiVo in our fight. A few minutes, guys.
All I know.
Here, Ashley, hey, here. I have a script. It's scripture for everyone. Get around. Philippians 3, 7 and 8. I think this will be good for all of us. Here, a little closer. Come on. Right. Verse 7. At one time, all these things were important to me, meaning all this, these things here, the video games and the pizza. But because of Christ, I decided that they are worth nothing. Not only these things, but now I think that all things are worth nothing compared with the greatness of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. Because of Christ, I lost all these things, and now I know that they are all worthless trash. All I want now is Christ. Okay, so let's go to Devo now. Let's be fun. Let's have fun and stuff. And
Yeah.
Everyone have some.
No, we don't want that.
No, 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 no.
That's how you change the world. That's how you change the world. All my life I had big dreams to do big things and make a change. And all the while I just passed by the simple needs right here next to me. 'Cause there's a breaking heart that's falling apart and tear-filled eyes are looking back at me. God, won't you help me to see?
You can have a seat. Teens, that was encouraging. Thank you for sharing that with us. It's my job now to get us ready for communion. Amen. All right. So I'm excited to hear what Ray's going to be sharing. So let's sing a couple of songs. Let's get our hearts and our minds remembering Jesus and focusing at this time. Here we go. Spirit of the Living God.
Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on me. Spirit of
A few days later, when Jesus again entered Capernaum, the people heard that he had come home. They gathered in such large numbers that there was no room left, not even outside the door. And he preached the word to them. Some men came, bringing into him a paralyzed man, carried by four of them. Since they could not get him to Jesus because of the crowd, they made an opening in the roof above Jesus by digging through it, and then lowered the mat the man was on. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralyzed man, "Son, your sins are forgiven." Now some teachers of the law were sitting there thinking to themselves, "Why does this fellow talk like that? He's blaspheming. Who can forgive sins but God alone?" Immediately Jesus knew in his spirit that this was what they were thinking in their hearts, and he said to them, "Why are you thinking these things? Which is easier, to say to this paralyzed man, 'Your sins are forgiven,' or to say, 'Get up and take your mat and walk'? But I want you to know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins." So he said to the man, "I tell you, get up, take your mat, and go home." He got up, took his mat, walked out in full view of them all, and this amazed everyone. They praised God, saying, "We've never seen anything like this." At this point, I'm sold. But it didn't stop here. Thank God for Christ's tenacity. That would have sold me, like I said right there. But regarding dinner with the sinners, later on, he had dinner with Levi and his bunch, tax collectors and the like, folks like us. On hearing this, Jesus said to them, when they complained about it, that it is not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. I've not come to call the righteous, but sinners. One thing this scripture really highlights for me is Christ's tenacity. He couldn't make a move without being called on it, despite unerring rationale in his favor for everything that he did. And more, these incessant challenges had no impact on his mission, because he was divinely compelled out of love to win saving forgiveness. There's my word. Just another example of the least of these. So no one would feel him unapproachable, he approached everyone. Can we say a quick prayer? we are grateful for forgiveness. Lord Jesus, you won us through your passionate sacrifice, which we commemorate here, as you showed your apostles, and which has been passed now across two millennia. We love, thank, and praise you, Lord, as always, in your Son, Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. As Mike said earlier, if you had anticipated the first Sunday of the month would be the Benevolent Collection for Hope, circumstances have come along that have made that better for next week, so just bring it back. We'll only be collecting one today. And the one we're collecting, I can quote you a number of scriptures, cheerful giver and all the rest, but the bottom line is that this is a very pragmatic decision as well. This is a facility we have to maintain, our ministries that we have to run, our personnel we have to pay. This is all how we do God's work. God reaches out through all of us, and it's all as important just because it's tangible and pragmatic, it's still real. So the generous giver is a good idea. We've gotten a lot of blessings out of this faith that we have, and the one that we have the faith in
certainly giving a little back should seem like a reasonable option. Father God, thank you so much for the blessings in our lives. Thank you so much for the people that we're surrounded with in this church, for a brotherhood and sisterhood that we can look out on and depend on and know that we love them all and every one of them loves us. It's an amazing thing. I've been involved in a lot of places, but I've never been involved in anything like this church. The faith that's here, the drive that's here, the community that's here is just an amazing thing. And we're going to give back to you, Father, out of our excess, because we have excess, because of those blessings. And we thank you so much for them all. In Jesus' name, amen.
Roll Tide. Can't help it. All right, here we go. Let's all stand. Let's sing another song before we get the sermon from Mr. Miller. Let's hold to God's unchanging hand.
changing hand.
You got a hold to his hand.
God's a changing hand.
You got a build your hopes on things eternal. Oh, God's a changing hand. You got a hold to his hand. God's a changing hand. You got a hold to his hand.
God's a changing hand.
You got a build.
Speaking about the armor of God, and it's actually not just the armor of God, but it is the full armor of God. I tend to cut that off when I look at that a lot of times, and it is about the full armor of God.
Amen.
And I'm really excited about it. Something that's been burning on my heart for a few years to talk about. And you know, we have some friends that might be up in Boston, but it's really great to have the preteens in the service though with us today. They just got back from a great camp where the whole theme was about the armor of God, so that's exciting to have them here. They were pretty encouraging to me this morning. It just helped me to get more excited about it. I kind of want to share a little video that really is what this is kind of about today, and it's something that gets me pretty fired up. When I saw the movie, I was kind of like, whoa. So I hope you guys enjoy this.
I want every gun we have to fire on that man. Do it.
Think you got him? Now, if we're ready to get moving, we can finish this.
Sir?
So why does that speak to us? Why does it speak to you? Go ahead, preteens, teens, somebody. Why does that speak to you?
Invincibility.
Sherry?
God's powerful.
Okay. Yeah. Awesome. Yeah, we can stand up. When Satan is shooting at us, we can stand up against it. You know, I kind of think about, you know, Luke is kind of like Jesus for us in that scene, you know? The devil unloaded everything he had on him, and he stood through it, you know? And we want to be like Jesus, and I think that's why it speaks to us. And let's go ahead and read in Ephesians chapter 6 in verse 10. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For your struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, and against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground. And after you have done everything to stand, stand firm then, with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. In addition to all this, take up your shield of faith, with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, and pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always pray, or keep on praying for all the saints. Pray also for me that whenever I open my mouth, my words may be given to me so that I may fearlessly make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador and in chains. Pray that I may declare it fearlessly as I should. So we've been going through the book of Ephesians, and we've been talking a lot about standing and standing. And we need to be ready to stand in the battle. Yeah. And there is a battle. I should have put that up for you so you could have followed along. There is a battle. And whether you believe in it or not, it is there. Yeah. Got to be careful. Whether you believe in it or not, it is there. It's waiting for you when you step out the door. It's waiting for you even when you get up. Sometimes before you even get out of the house, the battle begins. You know, we're surrounded by sinners. We live with them. We worship with them. We work with sinners. We're all a mess. And the battle is waiting for us. Whether you want to opt out of it or not, you don't get a vote. The battle affects everyone. And so we have to prepare ourselves for that battle. And it's real. You know, Satan has lots of tactics. He wants to come at us to isolate us. You know, when you have a fire burning, everybody likes a fire when it starts getting colder and it's starting to get to be that time of year. And when you have that fire, you keep it stoked and you keep the wood burning. But if you take one of those coals or embers and isolate it and separate it by itself, it doesn't take long for it to get cold. And that's the way we are, too, when we're isolated. And so that's one of his strategies. You know, he wants to embitter us, to get us frustrated with each other, to have bitter feelings. He wants us to tear down instead of building each other up. You know, he has a lot of strategies, and we're going to kind of get into some of those here in a little bit. But the goal really is to silence and divide us, to keep us from being like Jesus. That's the real goal. And so I want to take another look at Ephesians chapter 6. You notice I color-coded some of the really important words in there, the ofs. Those are typically, you know, when you're taught speed reading, those are the words you skip over. But I want to draw attention to them because this is something that really jumped out at me. So the ones in blue, those are the essences. The things are made of those things. You know, the word of can mean a lot of different things. It can be like, you know, I'm from, you know, from Boston, let's say I'm not, but I'm one of the Millers of Boston, you know. You know, that's what people used to say in the old times. You don't hear that much anymore, but it can mean a lot of different things, but it's what you're made of. But it can also be possessive, like this belongs to somebody. And there are three things here that belong to somebody. There's the armor of God. It's his, and it's special. Yeah. There's the spirit of the sword, and that's pretty special, too. And then Satan has his weapons that belong to him that he uses and has mastery over as well. So I want to kind of zoom in on Satan's flaming arrows for a minute. So he tends to come out with this either with outright lies or he specializes really in half-truths. But he'll use them both indiscriminately. And he'll come after us personally. He'll tell us things like, you aren't good enough. You know, he'll tell you things, you don't deserve God's mercy. And he's right, we don't. We aren't good enough. We'll never be good enough. And so it's a half-truth. But then he takes it a step further and says, you need to hide. You need to run. Get away. And he'll start working us to our own detriment over things that are really true. We will never be good enough. We don't deserve God's mercy, and yet he gives it to us. Yeah. He tells us outright lies too, like, God can't love you. He can't forgive you. You've gone too far. You can never come back from this. Or the one that he hits a lot of people like me who are naturally deceived. Some of you are self-condemned, but I'm kind of on the other side of that. It's okay. It's no big deal. It's not a big deal. God doesn't really care. It's not that big a thing. You know, and you start justifying it away as not really something that, you know, is really, really kind of putting your future with God and eternity at stake. But the stakes really are high, and we have to take this pretty seriously. He's pretty effective at us coming at us personally. He's also good at coming at us interpersonally with other people.
Yeah.
You know, we get frustrated, and we get angry, and people hurt us, and we start feeling entitled to our anger and to our wrath, and we let it go because they hurt us. It's our right to feel angry here. It's our right. They have that coming. They deserve this that I'm about to unleash on them. And we'll justify ourselves in how we respond and treat other people. He'll tell us lies like, you know, I don't care. I'm just going to walk away. Let it burn. I don't care anymore. You know, he'll come at us with, God's reasonable. He's like, he understands. Who could ever forgive that person for what they did? But the reality of the Word of God comes at us and says, you know, if we don't show mercy, we won't be shown mercy.
Yeah.
And so, you know, the scriptures are what helps to bring us back from all that. But Satan, his lies, they're really effective. And I want to encourage you guys. You know, I remember as a young Christian, I read a really good book, or thought it was back then. It's been a long time since I've read it. But This Present Darkness. And, Daniel chapter 10, you see Daniel, he's fasting, he's praying to God. He's in a tight spot, you know, and he's feeling it. And he is crying out to God day and night for 3 weeks. And this angel comes to him. He's like, Daniel, you know, and Daniel's terrified. And he's like, you are highly esteemed in heaven. That's like so cool that an angel would come and say, you are highly esteemed in heaven. He had a reputation in heaven. I mean, and it was a good one. And the angel said, man, God heard you from the very first time you prayed. He's like, you know, I was disposed fighting the king of Persia. So he's fighting against the demons over Persia. This is like a general of angels fighting over demons in another region. And he's like, I had to wait until Michael. I mean, that's one of the big, big dudes, you know. He had to wait till Michael could come and relieve him so he could leave his post and come and attend to Daniel. That's like really awesome. We're so unaware sometimes of the battle that is going on around us. You know, and it's real. And whether you choose to believe it or not, it's here. And it's surrounding us, and there are angels and demons fighting over all of this. And I encourage you to sometime ask me about my angel story. But, you know, God sometimes does still reveal this to us and peel back the curtain once in a while to let us see. But whether we see it or not, it's happening around us. So the full armor of God. This is what we really want to focus on today and get our hearts behind this. You know, the armor of God, it's not ordinary. I think of, like David, when he was going up against Goliath, and Solomon wanted to give him his armor. And David tried it on, and it was really good armor. It was the king's armor. I think it had gold and stuff on it, too. You know, it was nice armor. But it didn't fit. And David's like, I can't use this. It doesn't fit me. And he went to fight, you know, Goliath with his faith and the slingshot, you know, but God's armor is not like that. I think of it more like, you know, Iron Man suit, and not like the old Iron Man suit, like the new one in like Infinity War and the Endgame and stuff, where it's like the nanotechnology that adapts to you and molds exactly to you and adapts to what you need and can become a lot of different things, a sword and a shield. And I think it's like really cool, and it's got like Jarvis, you know. It speaks to us through the Spirit and through the Word. You know, it's really cool. It's not ordinary. You know, you don't want to go to battle with something less than this. This is something that's special. It's not just some armor that was, you know, handed out to everybody in a sense. And, oh, this is just ordinary armor. Everybody gets it. This is God's armor. It's His. It's special. And we need to realize that this is not a fair fight. What we saw on that screen was not a fair fight. You know, every gun was aimed at him. And by, left to ourselves, we are practically defenseless against Satan. We're weak. But with his armor, it's not a fair fight. And so I want to talk about the belt of truth for a minute. And, you know, the belt of truth was something that kind of held everything together. And it helped to shoulder the load.
Here it comes.
So this is not armor. This is my backpack. This is my heavy backpack. This thing allows me to carry 50 to 70 pounds relatively comfortably. 50 pounds is never actually comfortable, but it's about as comfortable as you can get it. But the key is this right here. It's the belt. The belt helps to take the weight off your shoulders. See, that breastplate's heavy, and it helps to take that off. You know, truth is the same way. Let's look at if you could keep your finger in Ephesians 6, because we'll come back to that. But if you could turn to Romans 13.
Come on, Lottie.
And so in Romans 13, 12, we'll get there in a second. The belt carries the load. It lightens things. Well, what is so heavy? It's darkness. Darkness is heavy. You know, lies and deceit are heavy. When we tell a lie or hide who we really are, that becomes heavy and a burden that we drag and drag around. I'll never forget this brother came up to me, and he had been smoking for 10 years, hiding it from his wife, from his kids, from his brothers and sisters, and he was just broken about it. And he came up to me, and he's like, I just want to tell you what's been going on with me. And I've been hiding this from my friends and just all these people, and it's been killing me. And I was like, wow, you are so lucky. And he just kind of looked at me like, what are you talking about? And I'm like, brother, you could have been carrying that around for another 10, 20 years. That weight he was carrying around, Christ never intended for him to carry that.
Yeah.
But we do the same things, don't we? We'll carry things that we were never supposed to carry that are just so heavy. And we drag them around, you know, and it wears us out. We wonder why we're tired, you know, because we're carrying stuff we're not supposed to be carrying. In Romans 13, 12, let's see if I can get there. You know, it used to be easier to read this stuff. The night is nearly over and the day is almost here. So let us put aside the deeds of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us behave decently as in the daytime. You know, this is what the armor is. It's light. You know, I think of Jesus when he's talking about the yoke. You know, he's like, take my yoke upon you. It's easy. It's light. It fits. It feels good. You know, it's kind of the same way with putting on the belt of truth. Is it makes this walk lighter. You know, if we're shouldering all this without the help of God and being real and being open and being living a double standard, you know, one foot in, one foot out. That's no way to live. That's a burden that Jesus never wanted us to have to carry. And so I think it's really important that we start out, when we go to put on the full armor of God, to start out with integrity and honesty. Because when we have that, it holds it all together and it helps us to carry that load. We can't be fake. You know, read 1 John 1, chapter 5 through 2. Write that down. You want to know how to be a Christian for the long haul? Get that one down. Walk in the light as he is in the light. You know, God can't honor a lie. And that's why it's a heavy burden. God never intended us to walk that way. He wanted us to be in the light. Jesus said in John that we were afraid to come into the light for fear our deeds would be exposed. You know, that was how we used to live. But now we're disciples of Christ. And you know what? We're all sinners. We shouldn't be surprised by that, you know? We don't have to fake it. We don't have to be who we're not. But we also don't have to stay the way we were either. So it also talks about a breastplate of righteousness. So whose righteousness are we supposed to put on? Anyone? Teens? Whose righteousness are we supposed to put on? Okay, God's. What about our own righteousness? Are we supposed to put that on? Yeah, so I think the answer is yes. We're supposed to wear both Christ's righteousness and our own righteousness. And in Romans 13, where we were just at, in verse 14, it says, rather clothe yourselves with the Lord Christ and do not think about how to gratify the desires of the sinful nature. You know, the devil's right. We aren't good enough, but Jesus is. We need to put him on. It's not our righteousness and holiness that's going to get us there. We need to be connected to Jesus' righteousness, and we have to put that on. But we have a responsibility in it, too. If you turn back to Ephesians, we're going to be in chapter 4, which is just probably a page before where you were at, chapter 6. But Christ is good enough, and he is enough, and we can take confidence in that and stand against the devil with that righteousness. In Ephesians 4, verse 22, it says, "You were taught with regard to your former way of life to put off your old self, which is being corrupted by the deceitful desires, to be made new in attitude of your minds, and to put on the new self created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. Therefore, each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to his neighbor, for we are all members of one body." You know, part of it is we have to go back and take up the cross each day, just like Jesus said. We have to die to our old self, because it'll keep rearing its head, and we have to slay it whenever it pops up. You know, our own selfish desires, our appetites, our propensities for anger or frustration, gossip, whatever it was, you know, that keeps popping up. We have to kill that each day. And that's a part of putting on the armor of God. The first step before you can put on Jesus is you got to kind of kill the old self before you can put on the new self. And then this is also really about a mindset, getting our minds right before we face the day, before we face the battle. It's not about, you know, just stepping out the door and just being the fake happy Christian. You know, it's about going out there with a mindset of, I'm going to be like Jesus today. And when it comes at me, I'm not going to talk about my coworkers. When it comes at me, I'm not going to complain. When it comes at me, I'm not going to grumble. You know, whatever it is that your vice, you know, apply it. It's about setting your mind to be the new self, to be like Jesus today, to put on his righteousness. And then, this is a challenging one for me, the boots of the gospel of peace. You know, it talks about readiness in that, readiness of the gospel of peace. You know, your feet fitted with the readiness. I don't set my mind to go out there and share my faith each day, but that's really what it's talking about, is getting your mind set like that. You know, you act differently when you know that your coworkers know who you are, that they know you're the Christian. You act differently when you're at work, when you make yourself known and put yourself out there. Sometimes it's not comfortable. I remember I was given a hard time as a young sailor. And, you know, it's kind of like being in high school sometimes, being in the Navy, you know. It's not really much more mature than that. And so when I was, you know, the Christian who was, you know, giving my money to the church, they knew what I was doing. They could see where my money was going. When I was every Sunday, you know, that I had duty trading with other people to try and get to church when I was in port or midweeks, they saw those things. They saw that I wasn't going to the parties and going after the girls like the other guys on the boat. And at first they thought I was weird. They call me all kinds of things, Moonies and Robo Jesus and lots of things, you know. But one of the guys who gave it to me the hardest, I came across him, it was probably 15 or 20 years later, and he's like, "You know, Lonnie," he's like, "I'm so sorry that I gave you such a hard time." He's like, "I always respected you, though." He's like, "I always inwardly wanted to be more like you." And he was one of the guys that gave it to me the hardest, you know. But, you know, people will judge the church. They will judge Christianity. They will judge you when you put yourself out there as a Christian but don't act like it. You know, we need to be ready to hold out the gospel to people. You know who sees it the most? Our children. You know, we need to make our feet ready to hold out the gospel to our children, because they will see the hypocrisy in our life before anybody else ever will. And honestly, they're the most important people in our lives. They bring us the greatest amount of joy and fulfillment, at least in my own life. My daughter is just the biggest joy of my life. You know, she just brings me so much happiness. But I don't want my hypocrisy to damage her faith and to hurt her faith for ever being attracted to the kingdom of God and to Jesus. And so we have to really, for them and for the people that live around us, we have to prepare ourselves for them. And we have to be ready to share that faith with them. It needs to be a part of our mindset when we get up. That's the only way you can be ready to hold out the gospel to people. And then there's the shield of faith. You know, faith is a funny thing. It can be a lot of different things, mean a lot of different things. It can be a system. You know, it could be Islam. It could be Judaism. It could be Christianity. Faith could just be faith and believing that, you know, good things will happen. Faith can be faith that, you know, if I do really, really, really good things, that I'll go to heaven. You know, faith can be outright misplaced. But there's only one way that our faith will get us to heaven. And that's if our faith is in Jesus' record and taking God at his word and his will and aligning ours with it. You know, Jesus is the only one who's good enough to get through the doors of heaven. The rest of us, our hope is in him. But it's not just faith and faith or, you know, it's some other thing that can be misplaced. Our faith is in Jesus Christ and in his word. And it's no wonder that this is what can extinguish all the flaming arrows. You know, when you see Jesus in combat with the devil in Matthew 4, they're both going back and forth. It is written. You know, we need to grow our faith in God's word, because that's as much a part of what our faith is about as anything. And we need to be prepared to hold up that shield and extinguish those lies with truth. And the truth needs to be ready on our lips and our hearts and in our minds. It needs to take our thoughts captive and hold us in check. You know, our faith is great because we can grow it. You know, the Romans and stuff, they would interlock their shields and it could protect the whole group. You know, it's not just about even just protecting you. Your faith can protect other people and extinguish their arrows too that are coming at them. Then there's the helmet of salvation. You know, this is one of the hardest parts for me in Christianity. I appreciate Mike's sermon about heaven, and Wilf did one a couple years ago at the men's retreat that was just astounding. It was outstanding. It's not my strength is to really see heaven, to focus on heaven, to understand heaven, and who can understand it? You know, but our salvation, we do know what we've been saved from. And we do have a hope, and we need to try and grab a hold of that hope as best we can and understand it. You know, I'd set a goal a couple years ago to try and hike all 48 of the peaks over 4,000 feet in New Hampshire White Mountains. It was a 214-mile attempt that I was going to try. For 2 years, I worked out 13 hours a week at minimum. So that's 2 hours a day and a minimum of 3 hours on Saturday. And as it got closer, my Saturdays, I was going out for more like 16 hours at a whack. You know, working out. And I was training hard. I had it every day planned out. And something that convicted me is I heard this guy in the world say, "I'll know that you are serious about your dreams when I see it in your planner." You know, our dream for heaven, it should be evident in our schedule. If we're really serious, because when I was serious about that, there were no excuses. There was no excuses about money. There was no excuses about time. It didn't matter if I didn't feel like it. There were no excuses. I worked out every single workout, and I didn't make an excuse, and they were hard, and there were days I didn't want to, but there were no excuses because it was important to me. The goal was fixed in my mind, and it was clear, and I wanted it. We need that in our spiritual lives. It needs to be clear, but if it's something that's serious and important to you, you'll see it in your schedule. If it's not in your schedule, you're not serious about it. The world even recognizes that. You know, where you spend your time and your money, that's what you're serious about. You know, are we more serious about the world, about our kids' sports or whatever? Whatever it is, and I'm not trying to pick on that because I love kids' sports, but, you know, there's things that come at us that you know, we'll make time for that, and we'll even pull out the excuses or you know, not let the excuses get in the way of that stuff, and we'll make sure we get them there. And but we're not taking care of ourselves and our families spiritually. Yeah. You know, we're not taking the time. Is it really that important to us? We have to really do a gut check and ask that question. Because I think too many of us, you know, when we look at our weeks, you know, we're not putting on the full armor of God every day. You know, and I'm jumping ahead because there's still one more thing on the list here. The sword of the Spirit. You know, this is one area that, you know, I feel like if I have a strength in God, this is it. It is the Word of God. I really love the Word of God. And in John, one of my favorite scriptures, John 1 in verse 14, 15, and it talks about how Jesus was the Word. He became flesh. But through the Word, we can see His glory. We can see who He was through the Word of God, full of truth and full of grace. It's a wonderment what we have here. And we need to really treasure it. It is a treasure to where we can really know Jesus through it. But not only that, when we read the Word of God, it's the only way through, and prayer is a big part of this too, but it is really the only way that we will have an active faith that will be sustained. Yeah. It's the only way that we will really grow and mature is if we gain mastery of the Word. You know, we're not all going to be Bible scholars, but I remember hearing, you know, there was some old guy from probably 200 years ago that said that, you know, a farmer with his Bible is more prepared than any of the philosophers teaching in any university anywhere. You want to be enlightened? Get into this. You know, you want to be inspired, encouraged, but it helps us from wandering off into the darkness. It helps to keep us in check because it exposes our hearts. It lays open our thoughts. It fillets us, you know, if we let it. You know, that's another part of the John 1:5-2:3 or so. You know, if we don't let the Word of God have a place in our hearts, we really have to question where we are with Jesus. And I encourage you to go back and read that scripture because I really think that's one of the pivotal scriptures about staying a Christian. But, you know, what is this armor of God that it's talking about? I think we have a name that we kind of frame it. It's called quiet times, right? He goes on to say it's not really a part of the armor, but he says pray. He says it like three different times. Pray all kinds of prayers. Stay alert. Keep on praying for the church and all the people in it. You know, pray for each other. Now, I remember my aunt telling me one time, she's like, you know how I keep from struggling with sin? She's like, when I'm struggling with sin, I start praying for somebody else. I get my eyes off myself and I start praying for them. I thought that was really insightful. But, you know, when we step out the door, you know, are we putting on an armor that's kind of like this? You know, I mean, who wants to go to battle wearing something cheap like this? You know? But I think we're you know, it's easy for us to put on the belt of obliviousness, the coat of convenience, and the sandals of sleepiness, and head on out the door, you know? We just, you know, get up and don't even consider what is really in front of us. And even the cost of what's in front of us with our spouses, our family, our children, our coworkers. You know, Jesus is counting on us. He created us to be like Him. We are His ambassadors. He's making His appeal through us. He's counting on us. We are His tool against the devil to go out and save the world, to seek and save the lost. That's why he created us, to have a relationship with Him, but to also to be His children who go out and shed light on the rest of the world, sharing the Word of God with the people around us and with each other. We can't be haphazard about that. The stakes are too high. This is what real Christianity is about, and the fight is not fair. It is a battle. Whether you choose to think about it or not, it is there. And so I have a challenge for you. I want each of us to wake up and put on the full armor of God each day this week. And then I have another challenge. Find a person to be your partner to talk about it. You know, when I was training for this, I didn't really have somebody holding me accountable, but every day I went into work, I talked to my coworkers and I told them what I had done. Because I knew that if I stopped talking about it, people would ask me, hey, how's that going? And even though I wasn't going to entertain stopping, I knew that it would at least be something that I'm putting out there and making it public, that this is what I'm doing. And you know what? It also served to inspire some people. Some people started working out, you know, and doing things and getting out there. And, you know, when we do this and we work with each other, we will inspire each other as well. It's not just about accountability, which accountability, you know, is still a good thing. But share with, find somebody to share with this little challenge, to let them know, hey, this is how it's going with putting on the full armor of God. And I encourage you to do it, to take it seriously, take the challenge, because the fight isn't fair. When we have on God's armor, Jesus is protecting us. Satan doesn't stand a chance. It's not a fair fight. You know, Kylo Ren, he thought he was, you know, going to unleash all fury on Luke, you know, and he knew that wasn't a fair fight, but guess what? It wasn't a fair fight. You know, it wasn't a fair fight. You know, Luke beat him, you know, and that was pretty awesome. It isn't a fair fight. Understand that. The devil doesn't fight fair, but neither does God. You know, he gives us supernatural tools, and we can put on that Iron Man suit and have the Jarvis, you know, helping to guide us and take on the attacks, all of them, even when he's unleashing everything on us. We can stand, and we can come out of this in the end, living and reigning with God for all eternity in heaven, which I can't understand that. I try, but I know it's a good thing. But I also know what I've been saved from, and I don't want to go back to that. And I don't want my daughter to ever have to even live any of that mess, you know, that I grew up with. And that's why it's important to me. That's why I'm going to put on the full armor of God this week. And I encourage you to ask me how it's going. But take the challenge. Put it into practice. And to God be the glory.
Amen. Thank you, Lonnie, for that. And as we put on our full armors of God, let us stand and be hard-fighting soldiers. Amen. Right.